What discovery was so important that it changed the California landscape? Gold. Right, Eureka, I found it. That was the California Gold Rush. When gold was discovered in 1848, people from all over the world came to find their fortunes. Most of them came from the eastern part of the United States. This time in our state was called the Gold Rush. This video is about those early pioneers that settled the towns of Danville, San Ramon, and Alamo, as well as the train and farms that helped shape the area. We're also going to get a glimpse at what life was like for third graders in this valley. So, get out your chalkboard, put on your bonnets, and let's take notes.
The Gold Rush of 1848 brought large numbers of people to California. People were hoping to become rich. Just around this time, the Mexican-American War ended, and the U.S. gained control over all of California. This included the San Ramon Valley. Many of the new settlers purchased land with the money they had made from finding gold. Leo Norris was one of the first pioneers to settle here. In 1850, he and his wife, Jane, purchased 4,500 acres of land from Jose Maria Amador. This was their house, the first wood frame house in the valley. Marianne Jones arrived in Alamo in 1851 and helped start one of the first elementary schools. A.J. Young, on the far right, taught in several schools, including San Ramon and Danville. Daniel Inman first came to the San Ramon Valley in 1852. He purchased 400 acres in what is now Old Town Danville. One idea was to call the town Inmanville after his last name, but they decided on using his first name and called the area Danville. Walking through Danville today, you can see some of the original buildings. The Glass family had over 700 acres just south of the San Ramon Village. The house they built is now part of Forest Home Farms Historic Park, where it has become a museum. As the villages grew, more businesses were needed to keep up. Here's the San Ramon Valley Bank. This general merchandise store sold clothing, groceries, and tools, but it was also the post office and a place for people to meet and hang out. The Thorup Shoe Store in San Ramon opened in 1875. Back then, you wouldn't buy ready-made shoes. They would measure your feet and make the shoes specifically for you. Danville also had a fire department composed of volunteers. Nobody was paid to be a firefighter. Back then, before fire hydrants, they would fill milk cans with water and bring them to the fire. The livery stable provided a place where people could buy and rent horses, as well as give their horses boarding. And as automobiles became popular, gas stations and car repair shops became necessary. But what really connected the San Ramon Valley to other parts of California was the railroad. The trains were a way for people to travel farther, for mail to be sent faster, and for other goods to be sent in and out of the valley. Ranchers even stored their grain and hay in warehouses right next to the tracks. This way they could ship their products at a moment's notice. The advent of the train really allowed this area to grow, and the land around the Danville Depot soon became an important part of town. This is the Danville Depot as it was in the early 1900s. Look familiar? It should, because nowadays it's known as the Museum of the San Ramon Valley. When pioneers first came to the valley, children were not taught in schools. Oftentimes, a teacher would live in your house and teach you to read, write, and do math while you weren't working on the farm. Bret Hart, a famous writer from the pioneer times, was a tutor for four boys in the Tassajara Valley. Imagine sharing your bathroom with your teacher. The first Danville Grammar School was established in 1858, and the village of Alamo opened its first school building in 1873. The Tassajara one-room schoolhouse is the only schoolhouse that's still around from the 1800s. It closed its doors in 1946, but we're going to take a look back at what life was like for third graders back in the 1800s. A typical day would start with the kids lining up at the doorstep and saying the Pledge of Allegiance. Back then, the flag had only 38 stars, not like the 50 that we have today. Inside the classroom, the teacher would inspect each child for cleanliness.
Well, collar straight. Good for you.
First, there would be a Bible reading. And should you choose not to follow the rules or be disrespectful to your teacher, you'd be sent to the front of the room and have to put your nose in the small circle. You couldn't leave until the teacher let you. Underneath their desks, they kept small chalkboards to practice problems on.
Catherine, turn it around so I can see it. Very good. How many did he have left?
This is a typical beanbag relay race. Does your school still play games like this?
So we have them to thank as well.
After the game outside, the students would come in and read quietly from the McGuffey reader.
Girls, open up your books. You want to write today's date?
Practicing handwriting with a quill pen could be a messy affair. These children practice outside to minimize the mess that they're creating. Over time, it will become easier to write with a quill pen and ink.
I wrote 1868 today.
With the ringing of the bell, the kids knew the day was almost over, and they would be going home to take care of their chores and other responsibilities. Living on a farm, kids had a lot of chores. You had to care for animals, feed the chickens, gather eggs, pick vegetables for the garden. You might have been asked to drive a tractor or bring water to the adults working in the hot sun. You might even be thirsty yourself. Early farming relied heavily on horses. These horses are plowing the land so that seeds can be planted. The first major cash crop in this area was wheat. Cows were important for their milk. A farmer could take his cream to the creamery and have it turned into butter. Like sheep, the cattle were often herded to the market where they were sold for their meat. The cattle were put into a large pen where buyers could get a good look at them and decide which ones they wanted, then loaded up onto a truck and taken away. Almonds became a major cash crop. This is a sorting belt for almonds. They would be taken outside and have the chaff removed. The almonds were put into a box where they would be bagged and shipped. Walnuts grew well in this area also, but were often difficult to pick. The best way to get walnuts off a tree? Shake it vigorously with a tractor. All the walnuts fall to the ground, making it much easier to collect. Because the main mode of transportation was by horse, hay was grown and sold as feed for the horses. The hay was not only used for the farmers' horses, but was also shipped to other places like San Francisco, where horses were the main mode of transportation. After the hay was cut with the scythe, it was raked into large mounds where it could be easily managed and loaded onto wagons. It was brought downhill to a machine that would thresh the hay and make it easier to pack. Then the hay was transported carefully, very carefully down the hill. As gasoline and tractors gained popularity, they took over the work of the horses. Through the years, tractors evolved and horses were not needed as much. This machine would not only cut the hay, but bind it together in a bundle for easier pickup. There were new ways of raking up the hay, new ways of assembling the hay into piles, and finally a tractor that could now suck up the hay and form it into squares right there and then. Farming and agriculture have had a huge impact in the formation of the San Ramon Valley. Though not as much farming occurs in the valley nowadays, it's still an integral piece of our history.
Well, here we are, the last in the series of the videos. So why don't we talk a little bit about how this valley grew so much? A lot of it was due to transportation. Now, anybody know what the Iron Horse Trail is? Oh. Yes, Grant.
It's a biking trail.
It's a biking trail. What was it before it was the Iron Horse Trail?
Oh. Yes. It was a railroad.
It was a railroad. So with the advent of the train and the building of the freeways and the cars, we'll see how important transportation was to building this valley. In this video, we're going to follow the Iron Horse Trail as it looks today. This is what really brought the three communities of Danville, Alamo, and San Ramon together. So, all aboard.
Transportation is how we get around and how a community moves its products. We drive cars. We walk. We ride our bikes. Find alternatives to the automobile. And sometimes we fly. From up here we see Interstate 680, the freeway that cuts through the floor of our valley. It runs north and south. From the natives blazing trails with their feet, to the Spanish and their horses, up to the pioneers' wagons and stagecoaches, the San Ramon Valley has thrived on people being able to get around. Around 1877, railroads were being built in our country. Railroads allowed people to travel farther in a faster time, and also allowed farmers to ship their products to locations they never could have before. There were two types of trains. The freight train would carry products to be sold, and a passenger train would carry passengers. This footage is from a video about the Niles Canyon Railroad in Sinol, not far from here. This train belonged to the Southern Pacific Railroad, the same railroad that came through our valley. Two large depots were built in San Ramon and Danville, and a smaller one followed in Alamo. From 1914 to 1924, an electric railway took people to San Francisco and as far away as Sacramento. The train would also make day trips to Mount Diablo. The Southern Pacific stopped running in 1978, but its legacy lives on. Have you ever walked along the Iron Horse Trail? That's where the railroad used to be. The Iron Horse Trail follows the original railroad right-of-way and helps us remember the historic Southern Pacific train which cut through the valley. It's used by many people for walks and riding bikes. What was once steel and dirt is now lined with wildflowers and even a creek. Many important landmarks, businesses, and schools are situated right along the Iron Horse Trail. As transportation choices increased, more people were able to move out to this area, and there was a greater need for homes and businesses. Let's take a stroll along the trail and see what we find. The I-680 freeway was completed in 1966. Now people could commute with their cars daily to San Francisco and other places that used to be too far away. Danville and Alamo became bedroom communities, meaning that most of the people who lived there didn't work there. They commuted out of their city for their job. The population in the valley exploded with the freedom that the freeway brought. The car, which had begun to be popular in the early 1900s, was now king of all transportation. In 1997, BART trains began making their way through Dublin, further helping the area to expand. BART is a great alternative to driving and is better for the environment because it saves gas and creates less traffic. This population explosion created a need for more jobs. In 1982, a large piece of land in San Ramon became what we know of today as Bishop Ranch Business Park. It also turned San Ramon into a major employment center. There are approximately 200 companies with almost 20,000 jobs in Bishop Ranch Business Park. Maybe one of your parents works here. And if you walk all the way up into Alamo, you can walk around the Alamo Cemetery, where some of the valley's earliest pioneers are laid to rest. Let's take a look at who's there.
The very first burial site here was a little six-year-old girl by the name of Callie Chrisman, and she was buried here in 1856. The Stone family came from Iowa, and first there was Silas Stone and his wife Susanna Ward Stone. The Stones were farmers, and they were also very supportive of the schools. They started the first school. In fact, they built a log cabin on their property, which was used as a schoolroom for many children. We have Sarah Elizabeth Boone and James Boone and Travis Boone, and the Boones settled in San Ramon, and they had a farm called Boone Farm. And today, that farm area is being restored, and it's called Forest Home Farms in San Ramon. It's right along the boulevard. This is the gravesite of Callie Chrisman that I spoke to you about, the little six-year-old girl, and this is the oldest gravesite that we're aware of here in the cemetery. She was 6 years old, and she was buried here in 1856. How many of you have ever heard of Charlotte Wood? Well, we're all familiar with Charlotte Wood because there's a wonderful middle school here in our valley that's named after her. And Charlotte Wood was a school teacher in our valley for many, many, many years. And she's part of the Wood family. And the Wood family, as you can see, were also pioneers in our valley. Well, the Woods started a ranch, and they raised wheat and grain. They also had sheep and cattle and animals there for many, many years.
A tour of the cemetery is not only educational, but fun too. At the end, you get to do a rubbing of a gravestone. As the San Ramon Valley grew in the 20th century, the need to move from dirt trails to paved roads allowed for a boom in transportation. The car opened everything up, allowing people to travel farther away from the valley for work. The advent of the train and the building of the freeway were pivotal moments in the history of the San Ramon Valley. One can only wonder what will come next.